In this video, we are talking about SoFi. Now, of course, the SoFi stock has been getting a lot of attention and the stock is currently trending. And that has to do largely with the fact that there is a pretty decent short ratio out against the stock. And this has opened the way for the Moon Boys from Wall Street Bets to really grab the tiger by the tail and start swinging the cat. And that's pretty much what's happening with the stock at the moment. So with all of that said, I want to really look at the fundamentals, look at the financials at play behind the company, and really help you guys decide as to whether or not you should potentially be looking at the stock for your personal portfolio. So let's jump in and take a look. Before we jump into this video, can I please ask you a huge favor? Can you click on the like button below this video? This helps us rank these videos, and just by clicking that like button, you help support this channel. So one of the first things to know about SoFi is that the name is actually an acronym for social finance. And in fact, the company is pretty diversified in terms of their service offering. In fact, they have investment products, they have a number of loan products, including student financing, personal loans, home loans, credit cards, and then of course they also do things like insurance and credit and budgeting in terms of credit scoring, and of course they also have car and vehicle financing. So this is an app that is proving to be pretty popular. They have 2 million plus members on the platform, and this is supposedly growing every year. And in fact, having a look at some of the investor presentations, you could easily be fooled into thinking that the sky's the limit with this company, because actually everything that they've reported on is an upward trend. But of course, a lot of the numbers that they're talking about in their investor presentations is often vanity driven. So they are talking about massive growth in their member base, and we can see that is certainly the case. In terms of their product base, that's also been growing, and a lot of people actively participating from the platform in the various offers that they have. And so certainly these things look very positive, but the bottom line is, how much money are they making? Are they actually converting all of this growth into actual bottom line revenue? And the problem is that with a lot of these investor presentations, and I've spent the last couple of days really digging deep into what's going on behind the company will often always put their best foot forward. I mean, no company is really going to come out and focus on the negative aspects of what's going on. And there are certainly a lot of positive things going on with the company and the stock at the moment. But the reality of the situation is, we have to look at those financials. We have to look at the bottom line dollar that's being made, because this is what's going to ensure that the company continues its momentum along with the stock price. Because if there is a disparity between the value of the stock and the value of the company, ultimately the stock price is going to come to reflect that. So this is one of the reasons why I've been spending a considerable amount of time in the investor presentations. I've spent a lot of time in the financial reports, and I've really combed through multiple line items to really understand what is going on in terms of the finances. Now, before we jump into that stock sheet and talk about the financials, I think it's really important to understand the corporate mission behind the company, because I think this is the thing that has got a lot of people buying into the brand equity of what it is that they're offering. So from their own corporate overview on the investor site, this is a statement that they've put out saying that their mission is to help people reach financial independence and to realize their ambitions. And they're saying that financial independence doesn't just mean being rich, it means getting to a point where your money works for the life you want to live. Everything we do is geared towards helping our members to get their money right. And we're constantly innovating and building ways to give our members what they need to make that happen. And I think, as somebody who's passionate about personal finance, somebody who's passionate about teaching people about money, somebody who really did everything wrong with money in my early years and had to figure all of this stuff out, I really love what it is that they're trying to do. But as much as I love what it is that they're trying to do, we still have to look at the bottom line dollar revenue. Are they making money? Are they converting this vision into profit? Because without profit, there can be no growth. So let's jump in and have a look at the stock sheet and see exactly what's going on. Now, one of the interesting things about this stock, of course, is that SoFi has, of course, been around on the market for a short while. It's not the oldest stock out there, and they've managed to attain a 15 billion market cap in a relatively short period of time. Now, the price on the inception was 10.41, currently trading at 19.63 with no P ratio currently, and this is where I start to get concerned. Negative profit margin of negative 57.10%. Now, this is especially concerning in a financial company, because essentially when it comes to these sorts of financial companies, they should be getting their own money right as much as they're trying to teach everybody else and facilitate everybody else to get their money right. Now, the bottom line is they're sitting with negative net equity. That basically means the company is, for all intents and purposes, bankrupt. And whilst a lot of people don't want to hear this, and especially the Moon Boys, and I guarantee the Moon Boys are going to be on this video losing their minds in the comment section down below because of the things that I'm about to say. But a company that has negative equity, I almost don't look any further, because when you're starting to talk about negative equity, you are literally entering the most dangerous place that a business can be. A business can be making losses, but if it gets to a point where it's making losses and it's got negative equity, that is an exceptionally, exceptionally dangerous place to be. In fact, that is on the verge of death. Now, I know a lot of people are going to listen to these comments and they go, you're full of it, you're absolutely crazy, and they're going to go buck wild in the comment section. But I want you to stick with me for a little bit, because we're going to go into some of the details here. Now, look at this free cash flow. We've got here 18,970,000. Compare that to the market cap, and look, a lot of people don't like to draw this comparison, but the fact of the matter is, you've got a 15 billion market cap and you've only got 18 million in free cash flow. Something is drastically wrong. And in fact, when we come down to the year on years, this is where things start to become super, super interesting. There has been such major shareholder dilution in the short period of time that the stock's been available. They've gone from 38 million shares to 42 million to 365 million outstanding shares. So the kind of dilution that's happening here is just absolutely unbelievable. And this is one of the reasons why the company is able to stay afloat at the moment, is because they're largely relying and requiring that investors' income to come into the company to really help them stay afloat. And without that, they really would be in some deep, deep trouble. Now, look at this. The assets have pretty much stayed the same. No major growth there. Liabilities have pretty much stayed the same. They have made big improvements on the equity. They've moved from negative 339 million to negative 120 million. But the fact of the matter is, this company has not had positive equity from day one, and that is a big problem for me. On the flip side of that though, they are seeing revenue growth. Revenue has moved from 442 to 565 to 992 million. And that is great. I mean, it's wonderful that you've got a vanity figure of nearly $1 billion in revenue. But the bottom line is, how is that translating into profit? Well, for the first thing we have to look at is the gross profits. Gross profits are actually looking pretty healthy. One has to say that they're doing a pretty good job there. They've brought in just shy of $1 billion and they've retained just shy of 700 million. So in essence, they've got somewhere close to almost a 70% gross margin. And that's pretty phenomenal. But then things just go absolutely pear-shaped, because when you start looking at the operating income and you start having a look at the net incomes, my gosh, are these guys taking a hammering? They're getting beaten like a red-headed stepchild. Negative 670 million on the operating income and negative 566 million on the net incomes. And guys, I'm sorry, you just cannot run a business taking those kind of losses. Ultimately, they are reliant on investors' money. And no matter how you slice and dice this thing, no matter how many ways you look at the stock, no matter how many ways you try to justify it, these guys haven't quite figured out how to retain profit yet. And their operating expenses are astronomically ridiculous in comparison to their gross margins. Now, having a look at the free cash flow, I have to give them a point here. They have managed to pull their free cash flow to a positive. It was sitting in the red pretty much in the two reporting periods consecutive to this. But I mean, we're talking about 18 million in free cash flows when you're doing nearly $1 billion in revenue. Something is drastically wrong in terms of the way they're doing things. And of course, this leads us to our 12-point checklist. Now, this 12-point checklist is designed to seek out both growth and momentum, and it is based on fundamental analysis. A lot of people, especially those new to the channel, often don't understand the difference between fundamental investing and value investing, and they are indeed very different. Value investing seeks to find companies that are fairly valued or are cheaper than their actual valuation. And based on the stock price, this is really about picking up a discount and making sure that the company has good fundamentals. We're not so focused on the discount element. We rather focus on making sure that the company has value, that the company has positive cash flow, that the company is worth something and is going to be worth something in the future. And that's based on fundamentals. So of course, this brings us into our 12-point checklist. So the first question we're asking is essentially a momentum question. Has the stock price doubled since inception? And in this case, it has not, so we have to mark them down. Next, we look at a P ratio between 1 and 25. This is to ensure we don't overpay. Once again, we have to mark them down. Next, we're looking for profit margin in excess of 10%. And this is pretty obvious. You want a company who's got profit margins so they can make money, reinvest in themselves, and of course, grow that bottom line equity. Now, looking at the assets versus liabilities, once again, they have negative net equity. Big area of concern. In fact, this is the single point that would probably not make me invest in the stock ever until I see them for at least 3 or 4 consecutive periods move into the positive territory, especially on equity. That is a key thing. Looking at the dividend cost, by default, there's no dividend, so the cost of dividend is less than free cash flow. Number of outstanding shares have not been going down, and as I mentioned, major shareholder dilution going on. Total revenue has shown consistent growth. That's one area they're doing really well, as well as the gross profits. Like I said, operating close to 70% GP, and if only they can figure out how to retain a bit more of that, they'd probably do a hell of a lot better. In terms of the operating income, that is not showing growth, nor is net income, nor is operating cash flow, and nor is free cash flow. So fundamentally, the stock is very weak. In fact, on the fundamentals, they're only meeting 25% of our criteria, 75% of our criteria not being met. Now, somewhere along the line, some analyst has been smoking some good stuff because they reckon this is going to be at $25 over the next 12 months. Frankly speaking, I just cannot for the life of me see it. Return on equity sitting in the red at negative 59. Return on asset is in the red at negative 9, as is return on invested capital. And guys, this is the critical one. Net income versus total revenue is in the red by a factor of 57%, and that is pretty much where their losses are being racked up at the moment. So looking at my price prediction on this, there's still a lot of sentiment in this price for me personally. And so I even feel $18 is probably pushing the limits of it. And that would represent at least about an 8% loss over the next 12 months. Now, there is of course always a chance that the stock could turn. There is a chance of course that the price could rally. And that's gonna be largely based on sentiment because there are no fundamentals at play here. I would gladly come back to the stock once the fundamentals are really checking out a lot better, review the stock again, and definitely change my opinion because I don't have a certain bias towards a certain company or a certain stock. My bias is completely towards the fundamentals. And so on the fundamentals, I have this at a very, 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 very firm sell. So I'd love to know what your guys' thoughts and comments are around the stock. As I said, I'm pretty certain there's going to be a lot of moon boys commenting on this, losing their minds about the commentary that I've made, telling me that I'm completely wrong, telling me that you can't apply this kind of value or fundamental analysis to this kind of stock. And to that, I'm just going to say, guys, history will always prove me right or prove me wrong. And as I've always said, when it comes to these kind of stocks, when the sentiment goes, the stock price is always going to come to reflect what the company is really worth. So the stock is only going to be good for as long as the sentiment is good. And that is something that I'm personally not prepared to invest into. So if you did enjoy this video, please click the thumbs up, give us a like on this video, and help us get this video out. We would really appreciate it. And of course, if you do have any questions or comments, drop those to me in the comment section down below. And I'll catch you guys in the next one. Before you go, I'd just like to let you know that you can get access to all of our courses absolutely free of charge. There's no fees to pay, no Patreons to join, and all you have to do is visit our homepage of our website and click on the sign up button. Link is supplied in the description down below. Now, you'll get access to our stock investing course, our real estate investing course, as well as some really great courses on managing your personal finances. And of course, if you're not already subscribed to our channel, please consider subscribing. When you subscribe and join our Money Tribe here on YouTube, you'll get access to daily stock analysis videos, crypto analysis videos, as well as some really great personal finance content. And of course, all you have to do to subscribe is click on the subscribe button below this video. And don't forget to click on the bell icon to turn on notifications so that you get notified whenever we add new content here on YouTube.